Carpenter, lead investigator of NIST, and his co-project leader, Mark Gross. This is a crime. It's a cover-up. And this is just the beginning of the evidence that they've covered up. Also, they had interviewed many witnesses. In fact, 500 witnesses of first responders and medics and so forth were recorded in October after 9/11, and none of them are included in the 9/11 Commission report. And 118 of them recorded witnessing sounds of explosions and flashes of light at the onset of the destruction of both twin towers. 118 recorded ear witnesses, eyewitnesses, flashes of light, many of them, light at the different floors, floors 10 and 15, and up at the top. They described the explosions like a belt wrapping all the way around the building. There are up to 100 eyewitnesses who have been recorded by the 9/11 Commission report as well, talking about explosions, but none of them appear in the 9/11 Commission report itself. So this is damning evidence. Now, at the bottom of the rubble pile, what we see and what the first responders see is pools of molten iron. What they say they saw is molten steel. But the physicist, in fact, Stephen Jones, who analyzes some of this molten material, finds that it is indeed not melted structural steel. This is very important because molten iron, which is what he determines it to be, it has in it also the trace signature of thermite, which you discussed yesterday, this incendiary, which melts steel like butter. So it appears, just from the molten metal alone, that this is the result of thermite, and it shouldn't even be there. It's steel or iron doesn't even melt until about 3,000 degrees centigrade, and these fires, and even the jet fuel, doesn't burn hotter than 1,400 or 1,600 degrees as a hydrocarbon. So what created more than twice that amount of temperature? The only rational explanation is thermite, which produces molten iron as its byproduct voluminously at 4,500 degrees. So this is the only explanation that accounts for all of the molten iron found underneath Building 7 and the Twin Towers. It's also the only explanation for the billions of small iron spheres found in every sampling by USGS and other environmental firms of molten iron. These spheres have also in them aluminum, manganese, and other components that are make it clear that it can only be the result of an aluminothermic response. This is absolutely extraordinary evidence in and of itself, found by official sources and documented in all of their literature. We've been told that, well, these are from the cleanup crew, the welding at the site. But the problem is these samples are found on top of the skyscraper, 2-3 blocks away, found on top of the bridge entry, the Brooklyn Bridge, collected only 10 minutes after the collapse. So this is very clear. Now, how would these spheres be formed? If you have thousands of cutter charges throughout the columns and beams in the building, and under explosive conditions, those thermite cutter charges released their molten iron. That molten iron is a liquid. It would be dispersed. What happens to a dispersed liquid? It turns into spheres, much like a spray bottle. When you spray it in the air, you get tens of thousands of very, very tiny droplets. So this cools and falls with all of the dust, and that's what is found in the dust. And yesterday, of course, you talked about small chips of nanothermite, unexploded or unignited thermite, that is in all of the dust samples that they've tested as well. So this is a very, very damning set of evidence that pulls the rug out from the official story of 9/11, and evidence that the architects and the engineers and others have not seen. So, of course, everybody's going to think, oh, we're conspiracy theorists, until they actually stop and are willing and have the courage to look at this evidence that we present in our DVD, 9/11 Blueprint for Truth, the Architecture of Destruction. So this is Richard, very carefully laid out in a two-hour DVD where all of this material is seen, and the videos of the witnesses and explosions, the collapsing of the Building 7 and the Twin Towers is analyzed. So a very, very important tool, which is available on our website.
Richard, I want to go through several of these points you've made in a little more detail. Now, you're talking about lateral ejection of steel and mid-air pulverization of concrete. Now, under normal conditions of a building falling, you're not going to have pulverized concrete. You're going to have chunks of concrete. As anyone who's seen any building fall, it falls in pieces. If a bomb hits a building in the Middle East, and we've seen a lot of that, you don't see pulverized buildings. You see scattered debris in chunks, macro chunks, large chunks. Now, I've spoken with a lot of people. I was at 9/11. I was down there that morning. I saw all this happen. And a lot of people talked about hearing the explosions. But we're talking about people who heard the explosions at different levels. There are those who have said, well, the explosions must all have happened at the bottom. Don't realize you couldn't have had all this happen just by having it happen at the bottom. You'd have had to have had explosions throughout the whole structure, correct?
Yes.
Well, then, how did anyone get the explosive material into the building? And because it was a very secure building, and because of a previous terrorist attack years before, and also get it to where it could be detonated, that would have had to have, after the planes hit the building, then someone at some point would have had to figure out, all right, now let's collapse this building down. And they would have had to have had it in place. So I'm concerned about who would have had access. Who could have planned this? This would have had to have been a lot of people working at the highest levels of the intelligence agencies who also know they had the power, if they wanted, to cover themselves. They wouldn't have had an FBI or a CIA or any intelligence agency investigating them. So they knew they could get away with this. No one's going to commit a crime they're going to get caught in. So now I want you to speculate. This is pure speculation. We have no hard evidence. But tell us what you believe is the scenario based upon a lot of coincidences happening at the same time. For example, we did know that there was a plot to hijack a plane and fly it into a major building. We did know that that there was a group involved with Al-Qaeda behind this. So it wasn't as if this was a complete surprise. Most Americans were told it was a complete surprise. Now we find out members of the intelligence agency knew this. Who did they share this information with? I want you to go through this scenario, and then I'd like the people in this audience to stop for a moment and just ask themselves a basic question. And if the question is reasonable, then follow it. If it's not, stop it. Here is my question. Who benefited from 9/11? Which industries? Which individuals? How much money have we spent on wars in Iraq and Afghanistan that we would not have been spending and not been there? It's now, according to Nobel Prize winning laureate and economics Joseph Stiglitz, it'll be $3 trillion. Which specific industries benefit most from this? And what connections do they have, like Halliburton, with Dick Cheney and Rumsfeld and the groups that they're affiliated with? Now, what would have happened had there been no 9/11? What was the popularity of President Bush? Would he have been elected again? What would have been his chances? These are all purely questions and speculation, because you must have a motive for any crime. We're not talking about a random outrage of a person going postal and hurting another person. We're talking about a methodical crime being committed. Now, even if everyone dismisses everything you and another 1,100 architects and engineers have to say about the physical matter and its contradictions,